I didn't know I had permission to murder into me. You want it darker. We kill the flame.
Greetings, Slashaholics. Welcome to episode 11 of Out of Print Slashers. Tonight we are going to be reviewing A Nightmare on Elm Street, Protege. I am here with the 80 Slasher Librarian, Josh LaRue. How you doing today?
Good. How's it going, Sean?
Doing great. Or going great.
Jeffrey Thomas sends his regards. He was going to be with us this week. He's got a lot of stuff going on that he couldn't get out of. He feels really bad. He's going to join us again in the future. And he just wanted to send out his apologies to you and me and the listeners. But he has a lot of fun being here, and he will be back one day.
Yeah, I thought this was
the... Oh, go ahead.
What? No, just,
the next 2 weeks. Yeah, see, the next 2 weeks, though, we're going to have a special guest on the program. We're going to have David Bergantino next week talking about Wes Craven's new Nightmare, the novelization, And then the week after that, Eric Morris is going to come back to talk about Jason's Curse.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that one. That Jason's Curse just, you know, the mask was passing between person to person, and honestly, I thought the person in book two won't say who it is just yet, yeah. But there had to be the most sympathetic Jason I've seen this far.
It was sad.
So yeah, getting into A Nightmare on Elm Street Protege, and as is the case with a lot of the Freddy books, gotta admit, didn't like it at first, because I just didn't know where it was going to go, and I kept thinking it was going to go one direction, it would go another, but upon the reread, I very much liked it. I liked that Freddy is trying to reinvigorate himself in the real world, kind of like what would go into Freddy vs. Jason, and it actually shows that this book has, in my opinion, bits and pieces of the movies in it. I mean, even when the book starts off, it starts with this woman on the freeway, and she's being chased by a car, which ends up being Freddy Krueger. And this, I think this was actually a deleted scene from what was going to be in Freddy vs. Jason. He was going to have a Freddy-mobile. I don't believe it got out of the storyboards, but everyone thought it was a bit too goofy for the tone that Ronnie Yu was trying to direct.
I really enjoyed the opening. Tim Waggoner is the author. I thought when I first started reading this for the channel, I was like, okay, so he's going to go Dream Child on us. But it's so much more than that once you get into the story. And it's got some interesting characters. And that opening scene, that opening nightmare, was a hell of a way to kick the book off, man. I really got to say I enjoyed that nightmare. The whole Freddy Mobile, the syringes, and all that.
Yeah, that was really weird. Cause I thought it was weird how they said her name was Joanna. I thought it was going to be Alice from Part 4 and 5, but I guess this is another woman, and it makes you wonder why Freddy targeted her in the first place, because it never really explains. It just says that Freddy was going after her because he wanted her unborn child. He wanted to infect the child with his essence to maybe make a clone or a version of himself in the real world. It's kind of hazy at first, but it gets explained later. I feel like Freddy Krueger was in this book to present exposition, because he always wants to explain everything that's going on whenever you see him, thankfully.
Yeah, I gotta say, out of all the Freddy books, it's weird that two of them are very dream master, dream childish, you know? Perchance to Dream is a direct sequel, pretty much, to The Dream Child. And this book has the feeling of Dream Child in it. A lot of comments that I got on this book were, it's very, you know, it's very much like The Dream Child, in a way.
Well, except it's
not Child the whole time.
Is it just me, or should this book have been called Dream Spawn and the other book been called Protege? Because to me, the woman's trying to be like Freddy in the other book, like Protege, and this one is Freddy's child. So I thought this should have been called Dream Spawn, but
for that, maybe the publishers gave him the titles and they tried to write it as close as they could to the story. I don't know. That's something we should have asked Jeffrey about, how he came up with the title for his book. I mean, his is pretty much on the nose, The Dream Dealers.
But yeah, that was specifically tailored to that book, but some of the others have kind of generic titles.
Yeah, like Suffer the Children. They suffer in every book and every movie. Before we get to the next section, I wanted to go ahead and play a little piece of that nightmare we're talking about.
Ooh.
Freddy Mobile. Yep. From the prologue, beginning of the book.
So, roll it.
There it goes.
The Firebird's engines rev several times, the car lurching and shaking, a wild animal eager to be let loose for the kill. With every rev of the engine, the unholy halo of fire surrounding the car flared brighter. "Sorry to do this to you, Joanna," Freddy said. "Ah, who am I kidding? I love doing this to you. And do you know why I chose you, Mommy? As much as I've had fun playing with you, I'm much more interested in the little bun you've got cooking in your oven. I had a child of my own once, but she was taken from me. So I thought, if I can't have one myself, why not adopt?" The spikes jutting forth from the Firebird's bumper began to change. They became clear as if the metal was transforming into plastic or glass. The tips became leaner, thinner, longer, until they resembled large needles. The spikes had mutated into giant hypodermics, and as Joanna watched, pitch-black liquid began bubbling up inside, filling them with viscous, ebon foulness. "Now this might sting a bit," Freddy laughed, and the car jumped forward, the rear tires spinning as they struggled to get traction on the slippery road. For an instant, Joanna was tempted to remain still and let the hell car finish her off. She was in so much pain already, and she was exhausted from running for her life. She didn't know if she had the strength to get to her feet, let alone start running again. But she looked at Freddy as the Firebird approached, and the dark glee in his eyes filled her with anger. Joanna would rather be damned than let this bastard have her baby. She reached down deep inside herself for whatever hidden reserves of strength she possessed, gritted her teeth in anticipation of the pain to come, and then stood. It was even worse than she'd expected, and she had to bite her tongue to keep from screaming. She took a lurching step forward, and her injured ankle threatened to buckle, but it held, so she figured it must not be broken. She increased her speed, half running, half hopping away from the Firebird across the endless open road. The Firebird picked up speed, baleful flames trailing behind the vehicle as if it were a fiendish comet shot straight out of Satan's sulfurous bunghole. The car's engine roar grew loud, louder and louder until Joanna felt its vibrations ripple through the marrow in her bones. The heat of its flames became more intense, and she could feel the skin on the back of her neck blister, smell the rank stink of burning hair. She turned, hoping to sidestep the Firebird and escape those deadly needles and the black ichor glistening on their tips, but exhaustion, both physical and emotional, had finally caught up with her. The Firebird's brakes engaged just as one of the needles plunged into the side of Joanna's swollen belly, and she screamed in agony. Time slowed down once more. She could do nothing as the hypo's plunger pushed forward, injecting its darkness deep into her. Then time returned to normal and the impact of the striking car flung her off the needle, and she flew through the air almost a dozen feet before landing painfully on slick asphalt. The Firebird sat motionless now, engines revving, flames flickering. "It's been fun," Freddy said, "but you know what they say. All good things must come to an agonizing, blood-splattered end. But don't worry about your little boy. I'll make sure to take good care of him once you're gone." The Firebird started forward, Freddy cackling uproariously, and Joanna screamed as death came for her.
Yeah, so now we get to the part of the story 17 years later. Freddy killed the mother, and the baby was born and raised up to be 17. And he seems like a normal teenager, but he has a lot of anger issues, just irrational. See, when I first read this book, his stepmother, Lynn, I thought she was always on his case, like, "You're staying out too late, you're doing this," but then I was like, she actually is right. She makes a lot of good sense, and she cares. It's Jerome that's about to bash her head in, like, "I was in 5 minutes late, so kill me! Ah!"
Yeah, there's such an inner, you know, battle between him and his dark side, And the reason I feel like it jumped to 17 is not just to keep the whole teenager thing going, but it feels like as he was coming into his adulthood is when this Freddy side of him, that, you know, the injection stuff that happened there and that clip we played, is really starting to come out. And this book is very much a battle of good versus evil inside of Jerome.
And it wasn't just when he was a teenager. They actually, throughout the book, they have examples of when he was a kid. They said at one point he killed a hamster because he was jealous about having a new brother. And that reminded me of Freddy's Dead, which had Freddy Krueger doing that when he was a kid. This whole book, I feel like bits and pieces of this book were like bits of the whole franchise, in a sense that you had the Dream Inception from 5, you had the Freddy car from Freddy vs. Jason, you have the hamster scene from Freddy's Dead. And I'm sure we'll find other examples throughout the book, but I like this book a lot more reading it again.
Yeah, that's. I wasn't saying that he didn't have those struggles when he was younger. I was saying, like, the biggest ones were coming as he...
I know, I mean, they just had, like, little snippets.
Yeah.
They didn't really focus on that.
That would have made the book so much longer, but it feels like, you know, he's got this relationship now, so it's not just him that's dealing with this problem, but, like, his best friend, the girl, you know, he's got other people in his life now that can be affected and hurt, you know, if he doesn't win this battle raging within himself.
And everyone can see that. I mean, he's made a lot of enemies in school because of irrationally lashing out at these people that bully you and you would just take it and walk on. He actually will attack and bite, and his actions actually create his main nemesis in this book, which is, let me see what his name was. I had it written down here. Cottrell. Cottrell is just a normal bully.
you know, for some of the stuff he does to the guy, because, you know, he does have irrational anger and stuff that pops out sometimes, so. But Cottrell is a piece of shit.
He is a piece of shit, but he knows Jerome has the strength of, like, two guys and will beat his ass, but he beat him back, saying to his buddies, we're going to get him, we're going to jump him. No, you're not. He is going to attack every one of you and put you in the hospital, but then he'll want revenge again.
Yeah, like, I know we're not there yet, but that car chase was a pretty cool segment of the book when they're chasing him down. But I like in the book how a little bit of Freddy will come out every now and then in Jerome's dialogue. And I would see that on the written page, and I would try to do, because this was still early on in the channel, so my narrations wasn't as good back then. But, like, I would try to take the voice I was doing for Jerome and just add just a little bit of Freddy to it to really show whenever the Freddy's coming through in the dialogue. Because that's how I pictured it in my head when I was reading it. You know, sometimes when Freddy was slipping through, it would come out in Jerome's voice.
The way I kind of picture it is like Spider-Man 3, Tobey Maguire, when he has the black suit on and he's putting his hair down, he's dressing grungy, and he's getting a little angrier, like, fix this damn door! I picture Jerome kind of going through this stage, because you see him struggle through this book. He doesn't know why he's so angry. He knows that these situations aren't even that big of a deal, and he starts to get angrier and angrier. This is actually what starts off the book. His mom, Joanne, had a twin sister named Rebecca. And Rebecca is into the spiritual and crystal balls and foresight, and she creates this dream catcher. Well, she gets it from some other merchant, but for the point of our conversation here, she gives Jerome the dream catcher to protect his dreams, and for 17 years has protected his dreams, but he gets angry one night, and he throws a shoe across the wall, hits the dream catcher, breaks it, and Freddy gets through. He's been held out for 17 years.
And the nightmares that he has with Freddy are really, really good in this book. I did enjoy them. You know, the TV, the fishing, all that stuff.
He was a referee.
Yes, yes.
I could have seen Robert Englund just chewing up those scenes as a referee. Oh, you're out!
Exactly. And him as a fisherman, that would have been hilarious.
Yeah.
But yeah, he breaks the dream catcher and he has his first nightmare with Freddy.
You want to roll that clip?
Yeah, let's do it.
Jerome opened his eyes. It was a bright, sunny day, clear blue sky with hardly a cloud in sight. He stood in the field of lush green grass, a gentle, warm breeze caressing his body. He looked down and saw that he was dressed in a blue t-shirt and black shorts, though he couldn't remember putting them on. He was wearing elbow pads and shin guards, too, as well as cleats, and he realized that he had a soccer uniform on. So far, the field had been quiet, save for the soft whisper of the breeze and the singing of birds somewhere off in the distance. But as if the realization that he was dressed in a soccer uniform was some sort of signal, the air erupted with noise. Spectators cheering encouragement, coaches shouting advice, players panting as they ran hard, their shoes thudding on the ground as they raced up and down the field in pursuit of a round white ball. A group of young men around Jerome's age, half wearing blue shirts, half green, ran past him. One of the blue shirts lagged behind and looked at Jerome as if he were crazy. "What's wrong with you, dude? Don't just stand there, let's play." Jerome didn't recognize the boy, but before he could ask how he'd gotten here, for he didn't have any memory of that either, the boy ran off after the others. Spectators on the sidelines, parents and younger siblings mostly, started to boo him, and more than a few shouted for him to get his ass in gear. Still unsure what was happening but not wishing to disappoint anyone, Jerome began jogging toward the mass of players, who were crowded together close to one of the goals, feet lashing out as each team tried to get and maintain control of the ball. As Jerome drew close to the other players, he said, "Whose goal is this?" to no one in particular. And one of the boys, he couldn't see which one or which team he was on, said, "Green, dumbass, just look at the goalie." Right, he hadn't been thinking. He took a quick glance at the shirt to double-check his own team. Yep, he was blue, so when the ball came rolling toward him, he knew what to do. He took control of it and started running toward the goal. Boys from both teams closed on his heels. It had been a long time since he'd played soccer. He'd quit after junior high, at least. At least he thought he had. But far from being rusty, he moved with speed and agility beyond any that he'd ever possessed before. It was as if everything there was to know about soccer, all the roles, all the moves, had been hardwired into his body, were part of his every DNA. He charged toward the green goal, the other players falling behind, unable to match his pace. He moved the ball from foot to foot with the ease of a master juggler, tossing a trio of objects into the air and catching them one by one, before one more launching them into the air. There was no way anyone was going to stop him from scoring, and sensing this, the spectators roared their approval. The green goalie crouched down, knees bent, shifting his weight from side to side, ready to dive in either direction and block Jerome's shot. He looked nervous but prepared. It didn't matter, though. Jerome was well and truly in the zone, and no amount of preparation was going to help the goalie stop him. When Jerome was within 10 feet of the green goal, he took aim and drew back his leg to kick. As he brought his foot forward, he looked down at the ball and truly saw it for the first time. Instead of being smooth, white, and spherical, the object was pale pink with an irregular surface and long yellow silken strands protruding from its top. But that was because it wasn't a ball at all. It was the severed head of a teenage girl with blue eyes. Eyes that blinked as she looked up at him, and long blonde hair. Though Jerome had only ever seen this girl in photographs, he instantly knew who she was. Joanna Larkin, his birth mother. He tried to pull his kick, but it was too late. His foot connected with the side of his mother's head with a sickening thump. Joanna shrieked in pain as her head was launched into the air by her son's kick. Jerome watched in frozen horror as she soared through the air towards the goal, which instead of being made from interwoven white rope, was now constructed from rusted barbed wire. Jerome prayed the goalie would be able to block the shot and prevent his mother's head from hitting the barbed wire, but the goalie was covered with blood, drenched with it as if he'd been plunged into a vat of liquid gore. When he tried to move, Jerome could see that his face, neck, hands, arms, and legs were covered with deep slash marks, the kind that a steel-clawed glove might make. The goalie managed to take only a single step before he literally fell to pieces. Bloody chunks of meat and bone pattering onto the grass like some sort of grisly rain. Without anything to stop its flight, Joanna Larkin's head flew into the goal net and hit the barbed wire backing. She screamed in agony as the barbs bit into her flesh and held her fast. Rivulets of blood ran from her wounds and trickled down onto the grass, adding to the crimson puddle created by the disassembled goalie. Jerome stood in silent shock, unable to believe what he'd just done. A roar erupted from the crowd, the cheers punctuated by shouts of, "Score! Goal! And way to go, Blue!" How could those lunatics cheer him after the abominable act he'd just performed? His paralysis broke and he turned toward the spectators, intending to denounce their barbarianism. But he stopped when he saw the transformation they'd undergone. They were different sizes, some fat, some thin, some tall, some short, and they wore different clothing, but suddenly they all had the same face, horribly burned, bald, with a hooked nose and nub ears, eyes that danced with madness and malice, and a mouth stretched wide in obscene delight. Jerome turned to his fellow players to see if they'd noticed the spectators' metamorphosis, but like the green goalie, they were all covered with blood and mutilated by slash marks. They were giving him the same twisted grin as the spectators, and then one by one they began to fall apart until all that remained of both teams were piles of shredded skin, muscle, and bone. "Hell of a shot, kid! Couldn't have done it better myself!" Jerome turned toward the voice. One of the spectators had stepped onto the field and was coming toward him. He had the same burnt features as the others, but he was dressed in a red and green striped sweater, brown pants, brown work boots, and an old-fashioned fedora rested at a jaunty angle atop his scarred head. But the apparition's most striking feature was a leather glove on his right hand, a glove with four blades attached, one for each finger, just like the one Jerome had imagined when he'd been angry with Lynn and at his father. As the burnt-faced man came striding toward Jerome, the grass where his feet touched turned black, shriveled, and died. Jerome sensed a presence about the strange figure, an unseen aura of malignant darkness that seemed to cackle silently around the scarred man like some sort of foul, negative energy. Anti-energy, sheer, absolutely, and total nothingness. It was the ultimate realization, the apotheosis of all that was dark and wicked and selfish and cruel and just plain wrong in existence. It wasn't merely evil. for that concept was far too simplistic, too limited to adequately describe this creature. This thing was as far beyond evil as a human being was beyond an insect on the evolutionary tree. Jerome sensed one thing more about the grinning, scar-faced, claw-gloved man. Somehow he was familiar, as if Jerome had met him someplace before. More than that, it was almost as if Jerome had known him all his life, even though he was positive this was the first time he'd ever seen the man. The man's smile faltered for an instant, and anger came into his bloodshot eyes, almost as if he knew what Jerome had been thinking. But then the anger passed as quickly as it had come, and Mr. Scarface was all smiles again. The man stopped when he reached Jerome and just stood for a moment, grinning as he looked the boy up and down. "You've grown some since the last time I saw you, Jerome!" The man reached out with his left hand, the one without the claw glove, and lifted Jerome's shirt up over his flat belly. "Got rid of the umbilical cord too, I see. Smart move! It's not healthy for a young man like you to be tied down to just one woman." He let go of Jerome's shirt and chuckled. The sound was like bones rattling in a tin can. Who are you? What do you want?" Jerome surprised himself by finding his voice. He was terrified of this man, and yet, at the same time, he wasn't. It was almost as if Jerome's personality had been split in two. One half of him was scared to death by his razor-fingered madman, but the other half was intrigued. That half of Jerome was the part that recognized the scarred man, and it was curious to learn more about him. "Call me Freddy," the man winked, his burnt, gummy eyelids sticking for a moment before pulling open again. "Everyone else does, and as for what I want, that's simple. Just to say, howdy. I've been trying to talk to you for years, but I was never able to get through to you. We had a bad case of telepathicus interruptus, you might say, until you had that little tantrum in your room and threw your shoe at the wall. Now you're receiving me loud and clear, Jerome. Can you hear me now?" Jerome frowned. He couldn't quite remember what Scarface, what Freddy, was talking about. It sounded familiar, but when he tried to recall the specific memory, he came up blank. A shadow passed over the field, as if clouds suddenly blocked the sun. Jerome looked up and saw a mass of pitch-black clouds. All right, but they weren't merely blocking the sun, they were devouring it, tearing moist yellow chunks out of it with sharp, ebon fangs, thick, lemony liquid squirting into the air with every bite. Jerome looked back down and saw that the ground beneath his feet was no longer covered with grass, but instead a thick layer of tiny brown furred bodies with long, thin tails. The creatures were obviously dead, for thick, writhing maggots squirmed over their still forms. Freddy chuckled. "Kirby the Jerby," he said. The sky continued to grow darker as Freddy walked toward the barbed wire goal, crushing dead gerbils and live maggots beneath his boots as he went. When he reached the goal, he grabbed Joanna's head by the hair and yanked it free of the wire. Joanna cried out in pain, and Freddy held up his gloved hand and jammed her head down onto two of his gloved knives. And this time, when she tried to cry out, black blood dribbled past her lips and over her chin. Freddy walked back toward Jerome, crushing more gerbils and maggots along the way. When he reached Jerome, he stopped and held Joanna's head up level with the boy's eyes. The head was still impossibly alive, its own eyes moving back and forth, mouth gaping open and closed as if she were a fish gasping for air. "We'll talk again," Freddy said. "Tonight was just the kickoff, a chance for the two of us to touch base, get to know one another a bit before the fun really gets started. But before you leave..." He shoved Joanna's head toward Jerome's face, and his mother spoke, but the voice that came out of her blood-smeared mouth belonged to Freddy, as if he were performing some sort of depraved ventriloquist act. "Give Mommy a kiss goodbye!" Before Jerome could react, Freddy thrust the head closer, and Joanna's bloody lips pressed against his. The cloud creatures devoured the last bit of the sun then, and the world was plunged into total darkness. The last thing Jerome was aware of as consciousness left him was the sound of Freddy's maniacal laughter.
So that's our first introduction into Freddy, and Jerome doesn't know who the hell Freddy is, but Freddy has been waiting for this moment for 17 years. And he hints that he wants Jerome to be his dark avatar in the real world so he can wreak havoc. Now, I thought Freddy just wanted to kill people in the dream world and the living world, but then he explains that people have forgotten about him and he wants to make people remember, which he brought up in Freddy vs. Jason. It also makes me think, why did he... This is a really elaborate plan to make people remember him. He could have incepted someone's dream and made him a billboard or something, but he incepted a child, had to make the child evil.
Or he could have just sent Jason Voorhees to Springwood, you know, to kill some people. I don't know why nobody's ever thought of that. That would have made people think it was Freddy. Would have reminded them that Freddy existed, you know? Could have been
That sounds like a good idea. And there could be like a construction site they can fight at, and for some reason they could, you know, have a two-hour drive between Crystal Lake and Elm Street. It sounds great, man.
Yeah, because, you know, Jason's not going to give up killing, you know, so, and then Freddy's going to, you could have Freddy get mad that Jason's killing everybody, and that could be the reason that they fight. I mean,
ooh, and they can explain that four times in the movie. Yeah, that'll be cool.
Oh my God. Mind blower here. Jason died in water. Freddy died in fire. We got to be able to do something with that.
Aw, people are going to be so mad at this. Okay. So, yeah, this book actually surprised me because there are a lot of spiritual aspects in this book they haven't really brought up in the other ones. She had the tarot cards, Rebecca did. She actually explains that between waking and dreaming, there is a, I don't want to say dreamscape, but there is a plane of existence between the two. And she's constantly trying to fight Freddy on this, but it's weird because Freddy can go into this realm, but it's not quite a dream and it's not quite awake. So you're constantly figuring out who has the upper hand in the situation. Is it Rebecca or Freddy? And that kind of keeps you on your toes a little bit.
I love the character. I mean, I really enjoyed the character of Rebecca. I felt like sometimes it's like, okay, you don't have to keep it so vague with him. If you would have just come out and told him everything, you know, and not been so vague about things, maybe things would have went different. Because I hate that trope in horror movies, like a relative or a friend of the family knows something, and instead of just telling the person, they wait till the person's a certain age, then they tell him a little bit, or I'll tell you more about it later. And it's like, just tell him what's going on from the get-go. Don't wait till it's like life or death matter, you know?
Well, I'd say by the time they do that, they gathered the whole family and were just like, Jerome is being controlled by an evil madman that lives in the dream world, and everyone's just looking at her like, this is why you don't get invited to family reunions. But by that point, I was kind of glad because weird stuff had happened so far that they were all thinking, maybe, just maybe something's weird here. Because Jerome had been having weird visions in classes, and here's another thing. The frog scene, when they're dissecting frogs and he thought one came to life, it was kind of reminiscent of Nightmare on Elm Street 2 when he's in biology. So that's another check mark on our list of movies.
That voice I did for the frog, oh my God. Oh my God.
Hey, at least it wasn't a mosquito. You did a mosquito in a Freddy book too.
I like doing the mosquito. That was in Lost Highways, Dead Roads. Lost Roads. But yeah, the frog, it's like, don't cut me or something. I can't remember how I did it. And then it slowly turns into Freddy's voice, but still the frog. I had a lot of fun with this book. It's been so long since I narrated it, but I think this is the first one I did after Suffer the Children. So to me, this was like an amazing Freddy book. But there's a couple clips that we're not going to play that I hope everyone listening to this will listen to the book. Because a couple of my favorite parts in this book that we won't be playing audio from would be when Rebecca meets up with Freddy later in the book in the dreamscape. And when the bully, Cottrell, he has this wild-ass, like, car chase with Jerome. And the ending of that chase and the chaos that ensues from that is a pretty badass scene. Like, it was a really long chunk, and I didn't get bored with that part at all. But I'm getting ahead of ourselves, so... they had the family meeting, and the family, of course, reacted how, you know, most people would react if they're told that.
Well, with the biology and the frog, that's what led into Freddy and Pinocchio.
Yes.
When Freddy meets Jerome, Jerome's trying to understand what Freddy did to him, and he's asking him, have you ever heard Pinocchio, like the original story about the conscience? He didn't just hang around him like in the Disney version. He squashed him. And that's what I'm going to do. And he makes himself an orderly. It's him and another Freddy, so it kind of has the duality thing. They're holding him down, and they're going to cut his conscience out of him, and it's a cricket. And that was just a really messed up scene.
You know, we could have done some Pinocchio stuff in the backdrop, but I like the whole crystal ball, Wicked Witch thing.
You know, I didn't think of that. I was looking up crystal balls to try to figure that out, and the closest I could get was either Dorothy looking in the ball or the witch, and I was like, we could do Freddy for the witch. That'd be pretty cool, but I was sloppy with that Photoshop. You kind of cleaned it up.
I just kind of pictured Freddy's head on the cricket or something, you know? Anyways, let's roll a clip of Freddy cutting out the conscience. What do you say?
Roll it.
Here you go.
I just fell back asleep while waiting for Miss LeClaire to get back, that's all. She'll come into the office, her real office, any minute now, and I'll wake up and you'll be gone. Both of the Freddies cackled. You wish, said the one on the right. For you, it doesn't matter, the second one said. Asleep or awake. We're always there, they finished together. At the moment, Miss LeClaire came walking back into her office exactly as Jerome had predicted. Ah, good, I see you have the situation well in hand. He's putting up a fight, Freddy 1 said. But it's nothing we can't handle, ma'am, Freddy 2 added. Good, good. But I think the procedure will go more smoothly if we restrain him a bit more securely, don't you? Miss LeClaire gestured and Jerome hissed in pain. He looked down to see that his arms, from wrist to elbow, were now bound to the chair with loops of silvery razor wire. The wire cut into his flesh and thick drops of blood began to patter to the floor. Now that the razor wire was in place, the two Freddies let go of him, though they remained standing right next to his chair. I wouldn't struggle too much, Miss LeClaire said. You don't want to slice your hands off, and we certainly don't want them damaged. We have plans for those hands of yours, Jerome, and we'd hate to see them go to waste, she smiled. As much fun as that might be. Miss LeClaire raised her left hand, and Jerome saw she was wearing a brown glove with metal claws attached. She slashed her face with the finger knives, her skin parted like tissue paper, and her features fell away to reveal yet another grinning Freddy beneath. The pieces of Miss LeClaire's discarded face, hair included, evaporated like mist when they hit the floor. I'd say surprise, Freddy 3 said, but I bet you aren't, are you? The other two Freddies chuckled at this. Freddy 3 still wore Miss LeClaire's blouse and skirt, but instead of making him look ridiculous, the outfit somehow made him seem even more sinister than before. He stepped up to Jerome and touched the tip of the blade attached to his index finger to the soft underside of Jerome's jaw. The moment the metal came in contact with Jerome's skin, he drew in a hissing breath of air. The metal was damn cold, and the frigid temperature penetrated Jerome's bones and radiated cold throughout his body. Freddy leaned closer, allowing Jerome to get a good whiff of the foul odor wafting from his open mouth. Inhaling Freddy's breath was like dunking your nose in raw sewage, in which large chunks of rotting animal flesh had been marinating for several weeks. His nasal passages and throat felt suddenly thick and coated with the stench of Freddy's rancid breath.
Got a newsflash for you, Jerome. You've been a pet project of mine for the last 17 years. I haven't been able to keep up with you the way I would have liked during that time, thanks to the dreamcatcher your bitch of an aunt gave you. But now that you and I have been reunited, you can bet I'm gonna make up for lost time, son.
Freddy pulled his finger blade away from Jerome's chin, turned it downward, then hooked the tip over the collar of his shirt until it touched the first button. He put a bit of pressure on it, and the button popped off. Freddy repeated this procedure until every button had been sliced away, and Jerome's shirt hung open to reveal his scrawny white chest beneath. When that was done, Freddy nodded to his other two selves, and they each put a hand on Jerome's shoulders to steady him.
Tell me something, Jerome. Ever hear of a little guy named Pinocchio?
Despite the pain of the wounds and his growing fear, Jerome answered, I saw the cartoon when I was a kid. Freddy leaned forward and practically shouted his reply.
I don't mean the cutesy-wootsy Disney version. I'm talking about the real deal, the actual story that started it all.
Jerome shook his head.
Then permit me to smarten you up, kid. The story begins and goes along pretty much the same as all the wimp-ass version you're used to. without all the sickly sweet songs, of course. A lonely woodcarver makes a marionette and wishes it could be a living boy to keep him company. The puppet, which he of course names Pinocchio, comes to life and decides to go off and seek his fortune. A cricket warns old wooden head against going, tells him that he'll be breaking Geppetto's heart if he leaves. Pinocchio considers the cricket's advice for a moment before crushing the obnoxious little bug beneath one of his wooden feet and heading off into the big wide world to have himself a little fun.
That's awful, Jerome said. Freddy 3 shrugged.
That's fairy tales for ya. They can be awfully grim sometimes. Your situation is similar, Jerome. I'm Geppetto, and you're my puppet. But before I can pull your strings, I need to squash a nasty little thing you've picked up over the years that I was forced to neglect you.
What's that? Jerome said. Freddy grinned.
A conscience!
He jammed his knife glove into Jerome's bare abdomen, and the boy screamed as he felt the icy blades pierce skin and muscle before sinking deep into his soft parts. Jerome tried to pull away from the blades buried in his gut, but the razor wire around his forearms held him fast to the chair, as did the other two Freddies standing behind him. Jerome continued to scream as Freddy explored his insides, stirring his knives around as if he were looking for something. The pain was intolerable, and just as Jerome thought he was going to pass out, Freddy shouted,
"Gotcha!"
and yanked his finger claws out of Jerome's gut in a spray of blood and chunks of shredded intestine. Jerome felt something slipping out of him, heard something soft and wet hit the floor with a moist smack, and he realized with horror that he'd been disemboweled. Freddy held up his claw glove, and through blurry, tear-stained eyes, Jerome saw that a tiny, squirming insect was speared on the tip of the index finger claw. It was a cricket. With the flick of his claw, Freddy popped the cricket into his mouth and crunched it between his crooked, yellow teeth.
"Not bad!" Freddy said as he chewed thoughtfully. "Could use a little salt, though."
Freddy laughed then, his voice a cross between fingernails raking a chalkboard and bones caught in a meat grinder.
Scene after that is what leads into Freddy. When he got into Jerome, he planted a little piece of himself, and I thought Jerome was going to turn evil, but it turns out there's a twin growing inside him, and every time he hurts, every time he kills, he doesn't remember it, but the twin inside him gets bigger and bigger, and this is what leads into the fisherman scene, because now Freddy is going to show Jerome what his brother looks like as he just pulls the fish out of the water, and it's like a dangling, twisted... I'm almost picturing the Freddy from Part 5 where he's this twisted, deformed, baby-looking thing that's, like, screeching.
So we're going to go back-to-back clips, eh?
Go ahead.
All right, let's do it. Fisherman has been so awesome in a movie, for sure. Just picture Robert Englund doing this scene. Here we go.
He looked around, saw a distant shoreline, tall green trees, a heron standing close to the bank, scanning the shallow water in search of fish. He was sitting in a small outboard in the middle of what he used to call Big Fish Lake because his dad had once caught a huge catfish here. It had been so long since Jerome had been here that he couldn't recall the real name anymore.
"Emerald Lake,"
someone said, someone with a raspy, guttural voice, as if his vocal cords were a mass of scar tissue. Someone who was sat inside the boat facing Jerome. Freddy wore his green and red striped sweater, but instead of his fedora, he wore a brown fishing cap with a picture of a skeletal fish on the front. He was equipped for angling as well, only his pole wasn't made out of wood like Jerome's. It was fashioned from yellowish sections of bone, fitted one to the other, each segment smaller and thinner than the last, until at the very tip was what Jerome guessed to be the end bone from a pinky finger. A line of barbed wire stretched from the bony finger and down into the water. Freddy winked at Jerome.
"A smart fisherman knows to use good bait."
Jerome glanced down at Freddy's shoes and saw an open tackle box, wedged between them. Inside were freshly severed tongues and moist eyeballs. His stomach lurched. but it had been so long since he'd eaten that nothing came up. Freddy took in the surroundings and grimaced.
This place has a major case of the blands. Time for a Freddy-style makeover.
Freddy did nothing special that Jerome could detect, but the leaves on the trees began to wither and die, falling off their branches with tiny, shrill death cries. The heron at the edge of the shore looked suddenly alarmed. It spread its wings and launched into the air, but not fast enough to avoid the maw full of teeth that rose up out of the water beneath it, clamped down on its long bird legs and dragged it down. All that was left was a small slick of blood and several loose feathers drifting on the water. The sky began to grow crimson, the reddish illumination making the water resemble blood. Jerome sniffed the air. It even smelled like blood, warm and rank.
Much better,
Freddy said, but then he frowned, the action causing the scarred skin of his brow to crack and clear serum to ooze forward.
But it's still missing something.
Flames erupted from the water around them, as if the surface was covered with gasoline and someone had just tossed a lit match overboard.
Perfect! Much more festive, don't you think?
Jerome felt heat rolling off the burning lake, and sweat began beating on his skin.
Festive? Are you insane? Since the day I was born,
Freddy said with a feral grin.
Though I have to admit that I've gotten a tad worse since I died.
He roared with laughter, the sound of his dark merriment echoing across the burning lake like thunder.
This is a celebration, Jerome. You've reached an important milestone. Gone through a rite of passage. Have come of age. You've killed.
Freddy's bloodshot eyes glittered.
Felt great, didn't it? Believe me, I know.
Sweat poured off Jerome and he tried wiping it off his forehead with the back of his free hand, for he still had hold of his cane pole with the other. But all he succeeded in doing was smearing the moisture around. What the hell are you talking about? I haven't killed anyone.
I'm talking about what you did in the alley, when Catrille and those two little weasels that follow him around jumped you. Sure, a couple of the losers got away, but you took care of the third one, slammed his head against a brick wall, and made his skull pop like a water balloon.
Memories came slowly trickling back to Jerome then. He remembered going to Diana's Pizza for change, remembered being hauled into the alley by the three Pusketeers, being restrained by Eddie Jackson and Brent Haney while Catrille took a few cheap shots at him, and after that, Jerome didn't remember anything before returning to Showtime Video. I don't have any idea what you're talking about, freak, Jerome said, though he couldn't escape the feeling that somehow he was lying, even if he didn't know it.
Sure you do, Jerome. Old pal, or at least part of you does. A part that's been inside of you since you were born. A part that's been slowly growing all these years. And it's just about ready to burst out of its shell, big time.
Freddy leaned forward and his eyes blazed with the reflected light from the fires that surrounded them.
A part I put inside of you, Jerome, just before I killed your whore of a mother.
Before Jerome could react to Freddy's mad pronouncements, his bone pole jerked.
I got a bite!
Freddy turned toward the port side of the little boat and hauled back on his pole. Something rose forth from the fiery crimson water with a splash, and Freddy brought the object in closer to the boat. He gripped the barbed wire line with his ungloved hand, causing black blood to trickle from where the barbs punctured his scarred palm. He then held out his catch, which dripped red gore, for Jerome's inspection. The thing wriggling on the end of Freddy's line resembled a hideously deformed fetus. Its body was small, its limbs stunted, but its head was nearly full adult size, and it possessed features that Jerome knew all too well, for he saw them in the mirror every day, but this was more like a sadistic caricature. The creature had a length of barbed wire caught in its teeth, with presumably some sort of hooked attachment. And it was furiously gnawing at it, shredding its lips to bloody tatters.
Recognize this cute little fellow?
Freddy asked. The fetus thing struggled at the end of the barbed wire line, but it didn't look as if it were suffering, despite the gobbets of blood and flesh falling from its ruined mouth. Its brow was furrowed, its face red, its eyes blazing with fury. The thing wasn't in pain, and it was not afraid. It was mad, mad as hell. Jerome couldn't answer Freddy. All he could do was stare with revulsion at this distorted version of himself.
This is you, Jerome. part of you anyway. I know what you're thinking. He's a shrimp with a melon-sized head. But that's only because you've kept him locked up inside you for so long that he hasn't had a chance to grow much. But that's all gonna change now, now that I'm here to help him.
Freddy gazed at the writhing, wriggling creature with an expression that was almost one of affection.
And you too, Jerome. Thanks to your letting out in the alley to get a little exercise. He's already had a growth spurt. Just look at the size of that noggin. But he's still too small to keep, so we have to cut him loose. For now.
Freddy held fetus Jerome over the burning water, then slashed out with his claw knives. Steel blades cut through barbed wire as if it were thread, and the stunted creature with Jerome's face plunged back into the fiery lake, giving Jerome a last poisonous glare before disappearing beneath the surface. Jerome stared in disbelief at the spot where the thing had dropped back into the water. What the hell was that?
That was one of my children, Jerome. Just like you are.
Freddy tossed his bone pole overboard, and as it sank, he spread his arms wide. The burning surface of the lake started to bubble and roil, as if its flames now blazed hot enough to bring the water to a boil. Wisps of steam rose from the lake as shapes broke the surface. Hands, arms, heads, shoulders, dozens, no, hundreds of them. Children and teenagers, boys and girls, they moaned, cried, shouted and screamed as the flames licked their flesh and the boiling water cooked them alive.
These are my children too,
Freddy said. There was none of the usual mockery in his voice, only a sinister dark love for these poor, screaming, burning creatures.
Each one special to me, in his or her own way.
Freddy lowered his arms and looked at Jerome.
But of all of my sweet, beautiful children, you're one of the most special, Jerome. You and your,
Freddy smiled,
brother.
Jerome knew that Freddy wasn't talking about his half-brother Brian. He was referring to the stunted, malformed thing he'd hauled out of the lake several moments ago.
You see, they,
he gestured toward the screaming, burning youths thrashing in the water,
are the children of my heart. But you and your brother are the children of my darkness. You're a smart kid, so by now you've probably figured out that I exist within the realm of dreams. It's a great place. After all, here I'm.
Freddy vanished from the boat and his scarred face filled the entire sky.
God!
He said in a voice of crashing thunder. Jerome shrank away from the gigantic countenance. But then he blinked and Freddy was his normal size once more, sitting in the boat and facing him again.
But as omnipotent as I am here, and as much as it chaps my ass to admit it, I'm limited when it comes to the trouble that I can cause in the physical world. I keep trying, but something always happens to send me right back here. Usually some snot-nosed punk,
he growled.
But do I give up? No way. Not Freddy Krueger, the Springwood Slasher. Stubborn old boogeyman that I am, I came up with a plan to establish a permanent presence in what you bone bags so smugly refer to as the real world. And 17 years ago, I put that plan into motion.
The final word came out as a demonic growl. Then a cold chill raced through Jerome, as if his entire blood supply had suddenly been replaced with Freon. Freddy leaned forward and slowly pulled scarred, cracked lips away from twisted yellow teeth in a terrible parody of a smile.
You're that plan, Jerome. You. You and your brother.
Freddy cackled and gripped the sides of the boat. He began swaying back and forth, rocking the outboard, slowly at first, but then with increasingly violent motions. His laughter grew louder, wilder, darker, and his eyes blazed with madness. Jerome tried to grab hold of the boat to steady himself, but the metal of the hull crumbled to rusty red flakes beneath his hands. Freddy gave the boat a hard jerk to the right, and Jerome, unable to stop himself, slipped overboard and plunged into the flame-flecked lake. Every inch of Jerome's skin burned as if he'd been dunked in acid. The heat from the boiling water instantly penetrated his cells and began cooking him from the inside out. His mouth was open as he went under, and he took a reflexive breath, sucking in double lungfuls of liquid fire. He tried to scream, but all that came out of his mouth was a shower of bubbles. His eyes began to poach in their sockets, and he squeezed his eyelids shut, but the thin layers of flesh were no protection against the water's heat. Jerome thrashed his arms and legs in the desperate hope of reaching the surface and somehow climbing back into the boat. He didn't care about the flames burning on top of the water. Didn't care that Freddy still waited for him in the boat. The super hot lake water was boiling him alive, and he had to get out of it if he were to have any hope of surviving. He felt himself rising upward. At least, he hoped it was upward. His eyes were closed and he was in so much pain that at the moment he wasn't the best judge of direction. But before he could reach the surface, he felt hands all over him, grabbing his clothes, clawing at his skin, snatching at his hair. At first he thought Freddy had leaped into the lake to come after him, but there was too many hands, and then he knew what was happening. Freddy's children, the ones that had been burning and screaming in the lake, had converged upon him, taken hold, and were attempting to prevent him from reaching the surface. Despite the maddening pain caused by his boiling flesh, Jerome fought his attackers, hit, kicked, gouged, and bit, in an attempt to force them to let him go. But they held on fast, as if they no longer experienced any pain of their own. Jerome's exertion soon grew weaker, his energy drained from the pain that seared his nerve endings, and from lack of oxygen to his brain. Freddy's children seemed to have no such needs, or at least not to feel or care about their lack of. Jerome soon stopped thrashing and just lay in the boiling water, held under by the boys and girls that had preceded him into death, courtesy of Mr. Freddy Krueger. And then a darkness much deeper and more final than the mere absence of sight came for him. And as it engulfed him, he thought he heard Freddy's mad cackle one last time. And then he heard no more.
Okay, so now you're probably wondering when his evil twin, they kept calling his brother Jerome, is going to start happening. And at a certain point, Jerome tries to incapacitate himself so he can't hurt anyone, but he ends up giving the reins to evil Jerome, and evil Jerome just goes berserk in these really gruesome ways. Now, when I first saw these, I was kind of annoyed because one of the great things about Freddy is that he's in the dream world. He can make anything happen. He is only limited by his imagination. But Jerome in the real world, the evil Jerome, he's kind of just mutilating and killing people in really messed up ways.
And I want to take a step back for a second because Jerome has a best friend in this book whose name is?
L.
And L is a cinephile, and his family owns a video store. Anybody listening who don't know what a video store is, back in the olden times, we didn't have streaming services. We went and rented videotapes and DVDs at a video store. There was this ancient store called Blockbuster was the main one. Anyway, so L's family owns a video store, and his friend is a cinephile. So his friend is kind of getting a kick out of this whole thing. You know, it's like he's being supportive on one hand, but on the other hand, it's like he's almost frothing at the mouth because he's involved with something like what Jerome is going through. You know, it's like, I feel bad for you, buddy, but at the same time, it's like I can picture L being like, fucking awesome, you know?
Yeah, it's really interesting you say that because they're watching this schlock film. I think it was Two Heads Are Better Than None or Two Heads Are Scarier Than None, and Freddy picks that and uses that as nightmare fuel for the rest of the book. There are always these long corridors with Freddy being the doctor and people that Jerome's killed become the two-headed, three-headed monstrosity, and I can just picture it being black and white. You ever seen that movie Monkey Bone? It was like 1997. Yes. When he's in the nightmare scene, everything's black and white. I picture that for the Freddy Krueger doctor scene.
Oh yeah, that nightmare sequence plays a big part with the whole, like, with the big chunk of the book. You know, it keeps coming back, and it was just some really good imagery written by Tim Waggoner there. Really pulls you into the nightmares. And that's something about these books, I gotta say, for the most part, with the exception of maybe one of the books, the nightmares in these Black Flame Freddy books have been pretty damn good, you know?
Yeah.
If you have a good imagination and can really, you know, make that scene play out in your head. And the whole Mad Dr. Freddy thing and the multiple heads was freaking hilarious. And without spoiling too much, which I'm probably going to anyways,
Wait. 3, 2, 1 for spoilers. Go.
When L meets his fate in the book, he kind of gets his horror movie cinephile wish in a way, you know, with the way that plays out. So, you want to do the last clip at the video store?
Roll it.
L fell backward, losing his grip on the machete as instinctively windmilled his arms to try and catch himself. The machete tumbled through the air, and swift as a striking cobra, Jerome's hand shot forth and snatched the weapon out of the air. Jerome then released his grip on Cheryl's neck as he lunged forward, spinning the machete around in his hand until the blade was pointing downward. Then, just as L hit the floor, Jerome stabbed the blade into his chest. L's eyes flew wide, and bloody froth bubbled past his lips. His body twitched as if he were experiencing a series of electrical shocks that diminished with each passing second. Blood spread out from beneath his back, giving him a pair of dark crimson wings, as if he were some sort of death angel. His gaze, already dulling, sought out Cheryl, but his eyes seemed to be having trouble focusing because they never fixed upon her. And then, just as she thought he was finally looking at her, his body stopped trembling and went slack, and the last remaining bit of life in his eyes went out in a heartbeat. A final hissing breath escaped his lungs, and then he lay still, staring sightlessly at her, and Cheryl knew L was dead. Evil Jerome regarded L's corpse for a moment before turning his attention to her. That was fun! What do you want to do now? Her throat finally free of his grip, Cheryl took a long, deep breath and then screamed as hard and as loud as she could. Jerome opened his eyes and winced as the light sent a wave of pain crashing through his skull. He groaned, as much from exasperation as from the throbbing in his head. He was really getting tired of being knocked unconscious. He opened his eyes once more, but this time kept them squinted against the light. He pushed himself to his hands and knees, moving carefully to avoid slipping on the blood-slicked tile again, and rose unsteadily to his feet. Cheryl? Elle? She's gone. I, unfortunately, am still very much present. The voice came from behind Jerome. It belonged to Elle, but he spoke in a cold monotone with no trace of his usual humor. Unease fluttered in Jerome's gut, and he tried to make himself turn to look at his friend, but he couldn't do it. When you say Cheryl's gone, do you mean... Don't worry, she's still alive, which is more than some of us can say. Jerome then heard a scratching, scuffling sound that made him think of a crab clawing its way across rock. The sound was coming toward him, but he still couldn't force himself to look, nor could he make himself flee. He could only stand there and wait for whatever was going to happen next. It's too bad you didn't succeed in drowning yourself, L said. A second scuttling sound, this one also nearby. Yes, too bad, a woman's voice, one he recognized. More sounds of movement, these from behind the front counter. Would have spared us suffering, a breathy gurgle barely recognizing as a human voice, a sound that might have come from a mangled throat and a mouth filled with broken teeth. The scratching, scuttling sounds came from three directions now, and they were all converging on him. Jerome, his back still to whomever or whatever made those sounds, imagined three human-sized crabs moving toward him like a trio of armored-covered spiders. I'm back in the dreamscape again, aren't I? He said. The Belascos, mother, father, and son, ignored his question as they continued crawling across the blood-covered floor toward him. I thought you were my friend, L said. Jerome knew he wasn't hearing the voice of the real L, and that this was just another of Freddy's endless supply of torments. Nevertheless, he couldn't allow that statement to pass without comment. He turned to face the Belascos. L and Mrs. Belasco were the closest to him, both crawling on all fours, arms and legs outstretched and bent at unnatural angles, heads raised high, eyes that should have been dead instead were horribly alive, moving rapidly back and forth, scanning their surroundings like foraging insects. Mr. Belasco was just coming out from behind the checkout counter, his body a broken, mutilated ruin of meat, bone, and blood that held only the merest resemblance to human form. He was forced to move by pulling himself forward with his only good hand, sliding across the tiled floor, dragging Viscera behind and leaving a bloody trail like some nightmarish species of a snail. Jerome knew they weren't real. Prayed to Christ that they weren't, but he couldn't keep himself from responding as if they were real. I'm so sorry. His voice was thick with grief, and tears began streaming from his eyes. I tried to kill myself, I really did, but it was the wrong thing to do. Freddy wanted me to attempt suicide so that my other self... The Belascos had continued scuttling and sliding toward him while he talked. L was the first to reach Jerome, and without hesitation, he bared blood-stained teeth and bit down on Jerome's left ankle. Jerome howled in pain and tried to shake L off, but his friend held on with the tenacity of a pit bull. If anything, his teeth sank even further into Jerome's flesh, and he wondered how long it would be before he felt his best friend's teeth gnawing on the bone beneath. A crazy thought flashed through his mind then. L, the real one, would have appreciated the irony of the situation. He'd become a monster starring in his very own schlock horror movie, Night of the Living Belascos. Mrs. Belasco was nearly upon him, and Jerome knew that if she got a hold of him, it was all over. He had no idea what would happen to him if he died here in the dreamscape, and he really didn't want to find out. Mrs. Belasco lunged for his other ankle, mouth gaping impossibly wide, as if like a snake she'd unhinged her jaw to feed. But before she could sink her teeth into him, Jerome kicked out with his right foot and connected with her nose. Cartilage smashed, blood squirted, and Mrs. Belasco's head snapped backward with a sickening crack. Jerome had broken her neck. Her body slumped to the floor, and while her eyes didn't stop their hideous back-and-forth movement, and her teeth didn't stop gnashing, the rest of her remained limp as a puppet tossed aside by its master. It was a horrible sight, but he didn't have time to react to what he'd done. Elle's mouth was clamped to his ankle, and like a vice, it seemed to tighten with the passage of each agonizing second. "I hate to do this, Elle," Jerome said through pain-gritted teeth, "but it's you or me, pal." He lifted his right foot and brought it down swift and hard on Elle's neck. Another snap of bone and Elle's teeth were torn from his leg by the impact. Jerome cried out in pain as Elle's body went limp as his mother's, but Elle's head still held on to its mockery of life, including the power of speech. "You'll never get back to the real world," Elle said. "Your body is lost to you, along with your identity. You're not Jerome Starkey anymore. He is, and you..." Elle paused, and then his lips formed a grin, stretching so wide they split at the edges, sending flesh tunnels of blood streaming down from his mouth. "You're nothing more than a dream." Elle laughed then, as did his mother, their voices wild and mad, like the cries of hyenas in the night. Far worse was Mr. Belasco. The bloody mound he'd become had almost managed to drag itself to the rest of them, and his laughter came as a horrid snuffling of air through a ravaged windpipe. Crimson froth spraying the air like the spouting of a dying well. Unable to stand the hellish laughter, Jerome turned and limped toward the front door.
That's one of my favorite parts right there, man.
It's extra cold-blooded because what happened to the others in the store, Jerome was wearing a hockey mask and a machete, so that was an extra Easter egg from Freddy vs. Jason that could have been seen in this.
You know, I never thought of it before, but I wonder if Tim Waggoner was offered Freddy vs. Jason, the novelization, first, and then they ended up giving it to Stephen Hand, so he just did all this
maybe
stuff into the book.
What this scene reminded me of is one of my favorite franchises, Sleepaway Camp. In the second one, they're trying to scare Angela, so two of the campers dress like, one dresses like Freddy, one dresses like Jason, but I don't think they had the copyrights because they look like really bad parodies. I think one had the hockey mask that was never used by Jason, and yeah, they go to scare her.
The VHS box of Friday the 13th 5, that kind of hockey mask.
Yeah, and spoilers if anyone hasn't seen this scene, so 3, 2, 1. They go to kill her, but she kills them dressed like Leatherface. So it was an extra cool scene. So the video store reminded me of this.
Oh, yeah, and there's a badass series called Cursed Films on Shudder. Yeah. And everybody who's listening should really check that out. It talks about, like, stuff that happened around The Omen, The Poltergeist, Exorcist, talked about The Crow, you know, Brandon Lee's death. But then Kane Hodder comes on sometimes and gets interviewed for his expertise in stunts. Like, they talk about the death of the actor and the two kids on the set of The Twilight Zone. And I just wanted to mention that real quick. Really great show on Shudder. You should check it out. But back to Protege, the video store. Jerome gets to play Jason a little bit. And one of my favorite aspects of the book is over at this point because the video store is pretty much gone. There's other nightmares and stuff that take place in the store that are really fun in the story. Even the non-nightmare stuff there is pretty cool, like just when they're watching the cheesy horror movies and whatnot. But we're finding ourselves towards the climax of the book here, which actually returns us to 1428 Elm Street.
Yeah, they keep calling it Freddy's house, and do they say somewhere in here that he... Because in the movies, it was Nancy's house, and I know in a draft of A Nightmare on Elm Street 3, Freddy was actually born in the house. That was where they based the novelization on the earlier script. But the 1420 Elm Street was vacant from A Nightmare on Elm Street 3 up until Freddy's dead. They put a family in there in Freddy vs. Jason, but I don't recall in this book them saying that Freddy used to live there. I know he'd always just... That was monumental because it was his first defeat as Supernatural Freddy, so that always held a candle to him, but it wasn't his house.
I think a lot of people made that. I think maybe like Tim, I'd have to ask him, I don't know for sure. I've tried reaching out to him, never heard back. But I think because in Nightmare 2, a lot of people don't pay attention to the context about how the glove got in the furnace in the basement,
and people
Freddy going there and putting it in there. So they just assume that Freddy was living there at some point. You know, I think it's just an assumption that grew, kind of like urban myths that grow into where people think it's true stories and stuff.
The Mandela effect.
Yeah, but for this case, for this book, when they say Freddy's house, they are talking about 1428 Elm Street. You can tell by the way they describe the house and everything. So what did you think of the final showdown that took place here with Freddy, Jerome, and Jerome's right-hand gal?
See, one thing I was trying to figure out in this book is evil Jerome a clone of Freddy? Is he Freddy's child? Because you think that throughout the book, but the relationship between him and Freddy at that climax, it really was father and son. Like, because he calls him Uncle Freddy, we're going to my Uncle Freddy, but when the climax happens, he's like, Dad? And that there was kind of sorrow there. And I wasn't expecting that from evil Jerome. There was actually kind of love there for his father.
Freddy has said, come to daddy, so many times, it was bound to finally be accurate.
Yeah, I mean, he kind of says it all the time, because he's nasty. He'll shock a teenage girl, come to daddy. Now he's like, come to daddy, I'm your father.
Kind of like Not Just a Job, that short story about Freddy.
Yeah, I like that. That was one of my favorites. Where he was kind of like a businessman. Like I used to work with your father. We were good buddies. I could just see him like his feet propped up on a desk. That was a good one.
You talking about Not Just a Job or Briefcase Full of Blues?
No, this is the one where the guy finds out that his dad was a serial killer and Freddy, okay, that was one of his buddies.
Okay, gotcha.
Yeah, I like that one a lot. That was interesting, because usually Freddy always stalks and tortures people, but in this one, he actually had kind of an admiration for him as a colleague, because Freddy doesn't have friends. And yeah, it was weird seeing the story, or cool, I should say, weird and cool, that Freddy had a friend to just hang out with and, I don't know, share a soul.
And just so everybody knows, we're not wanting to spoil a lot of this book, because it does have a pretty interesting story. You know, we've skated past a few things in the book, but I will say the whole Aunt Rebecca storyline is really interesting and really engaging, and I think other listeners and readers will really enjoy that part. That's one of my favorite parts, was, you know, the lessons and stuff that he got from Rebecca and taking him to that dreamscape. I really enjoyed the chase scene and what happened after the wreck between Cottrell and Jerome. I hated what happened to Elle, but I liked it at the same time because it was just really cool. But when we get to the conclusion of the book, it almost felt like the author didn't exactly know how he wanted to end it, because when we get to the cemetery after, you know, everything goes down... By the way, before I go there, in the house, what did you think of, like, the inanimate objects kind of coming to life? Like the chair that was holding her down.
I mean, I thought they were cool. It is weird because it looked like evil Jerome was leading her into the house and physically, but then Freddy is there. So are they in a dream? Are they not in a dream? It definitely seemed that gray area that Rebecca talked about, it seemed like Freddy... either that or the author just really wanted to show Freddy physically and have everyone be there. Or it could have been like...
it's like, you don't
dream spawn where everyone's asleep.
Yeah. Well, I mean, he doesn't really make it clear if they're asleep or not, but like... or if it's a dream or whatever, but yeah, like the chair pretty much comes to life and holds her down, like the springs in the chair. And it's a pretty cool battle. It's like, will he, won't he, which way is he going to go, is evil going to win out over good? And, you know, then we get the closing of the book, and it's kind of like the other ones in the series, you know? You think you're going to get one ending, but then you get did Freddy really get defeated, you know?
Yeah, maybe it's just open to interpretation, so... to me, an open interpretation ending is a way for an author... like I said, I don't know any of this. This is just my pure speculation. I think an open ending is a way for an author to give everyone the ending they want in their head, because sometimes if you give people an ending, they might absolutely hate it. But then you get people saying, well, you didn't tell me how it ended. It was all open. I don't like that ending either. You're not gonna win over everyone. I thought it was all right. I just felt that this ending was a lot... like Freddy versus Jason, in the sense of Freddy wants to be remembered, and no matter what happens, because there was killing, they're going to talk and bring him back. So he almost didn't need to go through this whole book. He just needed one person to know him.
Yeah.
He could have maybe given his name to a baby, so the baby said Freddy Krueger, and then someone started thinking about him, and then spread it through a whole town. Like, do we really need a child growing up and mutilating and killing people through a whole town?
With the blocks on the cover, it almost makes you think the most of the book's going to be about a kid, like a child. So that was a little misleading. But anybody wondering, the book ends like this. They're at a cemetery, and Don't Stop Believing starts playing on a radio that somebody's carrying. And a couple of the characters look over their shoulder and say, I didn't know he was coming, and then it fades to black, and that's the end. It gets the Sopranos ending. You know, it's just... Now, you know what? We're going to go ahead and do a spoiler here in 3, 2, 1, 0.
Really?
So, go ahead, and for anybody that stuck around to hear it, go ahead what did you think of the ending? Go ahead and give it a good description there.
Okay, so Freddy goes to attack Jerome, and Jerome jumps out of the body at the last minute, and Freddy kills the essence of evil Jerome. And I guess that destroys him, destroys Freddy, the whole house goes away. At the funeral, everyone thinks that Jerome killed all those people,
and
they hate him. They hate him for it, but, you know, the people that were around him know the truth. But then reporters start talking about, what about Freddy? He killed people years ago, and this person knowed Freddy, and they're like, people are going to talk, they're going to bring Freddy back, and they just decide to move away. That's just the end of the book.
That's it.
It's not going to stop anything. It almost makes the whole point of the book
pointless.
Meaningless.
Yeah, that's my biggest complaint about the book is the ending.
I guess Freddy won, if that was the point of the book. He got what he wanted. It just seemed... it seemed breaking a lot of eggs just to make an omelet, but way too many eggs.
In these books, Freddy generally has wins in the end one way or the other. You know, it's kind of like... at the end of these books, there's always some kind of mention that Freddy's still, you know, coming or whatever. But in Dream Dealers, for example, it made sense there because it was like the whole Dark Tower type of thing. You know, it's like they're going to be in this endless loop over and over and over again. You know what I'm talking about, right? After they wipe their minds and then they start doing exactly what they made themselves forget so they wouldn't do it again.
I think the only book that we've read that didn't have an ending like that was Dream Spawn, because Freddy was defeated, and the girl that had the last encounter, the last survivor, she is just in an asylum, spending the rest of her days there. It didn't reference Freddy again.
Yeah,
it seemed that when they pulled Freddy's heart out and burned it in the furnace, that was it.
But the other four, what I mean is, at least in Dream Dealers, the Freddy kind of winning out in the end was cool. But in the other books, it almost seems like a cop-out, you know? And it does sometimes just completely negate the whole story that came before it. And I don't care for that. So that's...
What are they going to say? It's the journey, not the destination.
Yeah, I would have given this book 4 stars. Or 4 finger knives. But instead, I think the most I can give this one is like 3. I enjoyed a lot of the characters, enjoyed the story. It seemed a little convoluted at times, but fun. Never really got boring. The dreams were very vivid, but the ending just kind of felt like a cop-out to me. So, I do recommend the book, but it's not the greatest. But it's a very good job. I would love to be able to talk to Tim Waggoner. I really did enjoy the book. I just, you know, not everybody's going to like the ending.
Yeah, I mean, I would give it a 3.5, not for that reason.
You're higher than me? Holy shit.
Well, I did really like the Freddy scenes in here, and it's difficult. I know it's difficult to toe the line between Freddy being funny and scary, and that was he did a really good job in this book, and to me, that merits the ending being bad. At least Freddy was handled better than he was in Suffer the Children. That is another can of worms we will open up later. But yeah. For the handling of Freddy, for the dream sequences, for the relationships between everybody. The only thing I docked on this one is, for being a Freddy Krueger book, I feel like Evil Jerome is a big part of the book, and he's just mutilating and killing people. And the point of Nightmare on Elm Street is for Freddy to do supernatural cool things, and seeing somebody have a knife and just gut somebody, it's not Freddy in the sense of how we've come to love Freddy. This is more akin to Jason, but Jason wouldn't prolong their torture. Jason would just kill them in a really fast, brutal way. So that is what draws the book down a little bit for me, but I would give it a solid 3.5. I did enjoy it. I enjoyed it a lot more than the last time I read it.
I cannot believe that you gave a score higher than me. You're usually more frugal with your points, you know?
No, I would have given a lower score if I had not reread this book, but I gained respect reading it again, so here we are.
And, you know, we harp on Suffer the Children a lot, but it's nowhere near as bad as Hell Lake or Death Moon. It's really
It's not bad, it's just not... If this was the level and bad is down here, the others are just way up here, and this one is just kind of your basic cut and dry, killing kids having problems with their parents...
You'd probably be surprised at what I would give that one book. It's not going to be as low as you think.
Yeah, because you don't hate it. It's just it's not as good as the other Freddy's.
And as much as I would love to talk to the author, I don't think that's ever going to happen. You know why. But
yeah.
Even after the slash, I'll go into more detail on that. But he seems like a nice enough guy, just maybe misunderstanding some things back in the day. But yeah, solid 3 for this one. I wanted to give it more, but the ending just totally detracted it for me. You know, I was struggling between giving it a 3 or 3.5, but it's not going to be the lowest ranked one, I don't think. It might be that I rate in this series. I'm really debating on if I need to up it a little bit, but that ending just was...
I have a way to fix it. They could have looked at the casket in the ground saying, he is not dead, but he must make the world believe that he is dead until he can quell the beast inside of him. An Incredible Hulk ending that he faked his own death to have everyone in Elm Street not know who he is. Saying that Freddy died with, you know, whoever's in the ground.
Well, all right, Slashaholics, you've heard it here. A Nightmare on Elm Street Protege by Tim Waggoner. I give it a 3. Sean gave it a 3.5. Regardless, you should really check this book out on the channel, or if you can find a physical copy somewhere, give it a read. There'll be a link at the end to watch it or listen to it. I think you'll really enjoy it. Even if it's not your favorite Freddy book, it's an awesome original story, and it expands the universe of Freddy Krueger in a fun way. The characters are fun. The nightmares are fun. Fun book all around. So until next time, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80s slasher librarian, Josh LaRue, saying, thanks for listening. Pleasant dreams. And we'll see you real soon. Woo!
And this is Sean Campbell saying, if this one doesn't scare you, you're already dead.
See you next time, folks. Be sure to click that link for the audiobook. It should be like right here.